Divine Truth Frequently Asked Question Session. Jesus, Mary and others provide answers to questions that are frequently asked by members of the media and public. This presentation is part of the Cults and Cult Leaders series. Mary asked Jesus questions on the subject of cult leaders having followers and control, recorded on the 30th of December 2012 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 2, Part 2.
Do you covertly attempt to control others?
Covertly attempt? I don't attempt to control others either covertly or overtly. The main reason why is that any attempt to control another person is out of harmony with the principles of divine truth. So again, I would suggest people have a look at the material that I gave on the gift of free will, and there are only a few times when you would actually attempt to control somebody in a physical sense. And I certainly don't engage in any of those type of forms of control anyway. My feeling is that most people are so afraid of being controlled that most of the time they're controlled almost every day by things and events that they really don't understand about. And the reason why is because they've got so much fear about being controlled. A lot of people project all of this stuff about cults at me because they have just so much fear inside of themselves of being controlled. Now, why does a person have fear inside of themselves about being controlled? It's primarily because when they grew up as a child, they were controlled most of the time. And that's why now, as an adult, they have so much fear in them about being controlled. If they dealt with this fear, if they actually released the emotions relating to the fear of being controlled as a child, and that requires them going through, you know, their childhood and looking at the different experiences they had with either one or both of their parents that were controlling, once they come out of that experience, they wouldn't have any fear of being controlled by anyone because they'd realize that they have the ability to walk away at any time, they have the ability to move away at any time, and even if somebody puts you in prison, they still can't control what you think, they still can't control what you desire, they still can't control what you put as your highest priorities in your life. So it's totally impossible for somebody to control another, particularly once we've released the fear of being controlled from ourselves. So I would suggest that anybody who's accusing me of controlling others probably needs to have a good look at the fear that they have regarding their own parents and the amount of control they received as a child.
You mentioned that when we have the fear of being controlled, we become controlled. How does that work?
Because we have the fear of being controlled, we are, and we're unable to release that fear, we are now not able to recognize when we're being controlled or manipulated by our own fear. And any sensitive person around us who is also manipulative and you know, what I would classify as unloving, will attempt to bribe us using our fear or blackmail us using our fear. And what I mean by that is they bribe us by giving us the things that our fear dictates we need, such as safety. So this is one way that governments bribe us. They say, oh, we're doing this because we're making you feel safer. The reality is they've just taken away half of your rights.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like what happened in the USA when 9/11 occurred. Mm-hmm. And then a government enacted a whole legislation that took away the rights of people saying they were doing that because they were, you know, providing more safety. And the reality is that is a method of control. You're basically saying to a person, I'm making you safe by taking away your right to decide. And that's not a way to make a person safe at all.
And people didn't question that because they're so caught up in not experiencing their fear of being unsafe.
Exactly.
That someone just has to say, I'm making you safer, when in actual fact, if they are in a situation where their civil rights would have protected them in the past, now they have less rights, so they're less safe.
So actually they're less safe. Yeah. They're less safe than they were before from a free will perspective, but they believe they're more safe because, and it's the fear of the lack of safety that drove them to that point. So this is how it's very, very easy to manipulate a person once they're out, you know, once they are not releasing their fear and they don't recognise they're living in this fear. It's very, very easy to manipulate a person after that. Now, a person who's loving won't do that. They won't manipulate your fear. What they'll do instead is they'll tell you, you've got this fear. It's a fear you need to address and deal with. Now, I certainly do that. I certainly tell people what fears they have when I notice they have those fears. And I tell them this is the way to release that fear. Once you release that fear, you won't be governed by it anymore. You won't be manipulated by it anymore. People outside of you are not going to be able to control you with it anymore. And that's a place of freedom, not a place of control. So I feel that a lot of people need to reappraise their assessment of how they view fear. And any person who says, oh, AJ is a person who's controlling, must have a lot of fear, because as you know, in my personal life, I don't control anybody, including yourself. Mm. So any person who's got that level of fear must have a lot of fear from their childhood that they're then imposing upon me.
And in actual fact, what I observe is that you're teaching people how to release their fears, to move through their fears, so that they can actually never be controlled.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And the problem for many is that some of them like being controlled because it gives them the ability to not have to make a personal choice. Mm-hmm. In other words, they don't have to take as much responsibility for their life. And some people obviously don't like being controlled, so they think everybody's going to control them when nobody really is. And I find that even just making a statement of truth to people, some people believe that's controlling. And it blows me away that they think that. But the reality is they're not used to hearing any truth from anybody. And when they do, they've always heard it in a manipulative way from their father or mother. So it's a bit like saying, you know, only telling somebody the truth when you want them to do something or you want them to feel bad about yourself. I don't do that. I tell people the truth all the time, and I don't have a motive for doing so other than just to be loving towards them. Mm. So people need to reassess, I feel, their belief systems about fear and their belief systems about control.
Cool. Do you do things to force people into an emotional experience?
Definitely not. All the times that I tell the truth to people, my motive is just to tell them the truth. I realise that telling somebody the truth does have the effect of emotionally opening them up. They emotionally connect with the truth generally, and as a result of that, if it's a truth that is a part of their life and has been a part of their life from their childhood that's unreleased, then there'll always be some emotional experience as a result come up. Now, sometimes the emotional experience is anger, sometimes it's shame, sometimes it's guilt, sometimes it's grief. It's preferable if it's grief, because obviously you get closer to the actual emotion that you felt as a child, but often people have to go through the layers of emotion before they hit that place. My only reason for telling a person the truth is because I can feel that is a truth they feel, and I'm voicing what they've always felt inside of themselves, but which they've never been able to feel free enough to express. And yet when they do express it, all of a sudden they connect emotionally, and now they have an experience, and this experience, it helps them see what the truth is, the truth that they actually do believe about their life or about their personal experience.
Hmm. But do you never force people to have an experience in your company?
No. I often are very, I'm like a dog with a bone with the truth, definitely. But I know the power of the truth. The truth sets you free. And I believe that with my whole being. So the power of the truth is such that I would not ever avoid telling it. The issue is whether the person wants to receive it or not. Now, if a person is in my company, I assume they want to receive the truth. If they're in my company and they don't want to receive the truth, then my suggestion is leave my company. That's okay, I'm okay with that. I'm always going to say the truth when a person's in my company. And most people who know me well enough now know that if they're with me at any point in time and in my company at any point in time, that at some point in time I'm going to raise the truth with them about how they're acting or how they've been or how what they feel or what they're projecting at me or whatever. Obviously, I do that because, firstly, if they are projecting different emotions at me or they are having different feelings about me they're not voicing and I'm sensitive to them, I want to say the truth about that. And it's my right because I'm involved in their life in that moment to say that. I have the free will choice, of course, to to suppress that, as most people might choose to do, but I don't choose to do that generally because I know the power of the truth. The power of the truth is always liberating. It always creates more freedom. And so that's why I'm so focused on telling people the truth when they're in my company. If I know a person does not want to hear the truth, then I won't generally share the truth with them. However, I probably also won't want to spend much time in their company. Mm-hmm. And so quite often people wonder why we don't spend much time in certain people's company. Well, most of the time it's because of their resistance to the truth. And for that reason, I don't feel strongly attracted to spending the time with people who are very, very resistive or blocked to the truth or get angry or needy about the truth. I prefer to just have a conversation, a truthful and open conversation with somebody who's frank and honest and open, as frank and honest and open with me as I am with them. And that allows us then to get to know each other properly. It enables us to interact truthfully, but it also enables both of us to grow.
And you mentioned that you're firm for truth, but that's not necessarily eliciting an emotional response in them, would you say?
No, I'm firm for truth whether they have an emotional response to it or not. Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to get an emotional response out of the person. I'm just firm for truth because I realise the power of the truth. Mm-hmm. I honour the power of the truth. I honour God's universe in that way. God's universe is all based around truth and love. And that's one way in which I honour that, by actually stating truth and being loving as I'm stating the truth with every person that I meet.
Do you attempt to emotionally threaten a person in order for them to do what you want?
Definitely not. I do not agree with emotional threats at all. I feel, though, that most people engage emotional threats almost every day, if not every hour or minute of their lives. If you think about the average interaction between a parent and a child, a lot of it is emotionally threatening in the sense that the child's behaviour is being controlled by the parent either withdrawing or giving something depending upon what the child does. And that is an emotional threat. That is it's probably more specific to say that it's more like a combination of bribes and threats. And I feel that this is how the majority of people interact with each other. They have a combination of bribes and threats. So the bribe is, I won't raise the truth about you if you don't raise the truth about me. That's a bribe.
Yeah.
A threat is, I'll raise the truth about you in public unless you do something for me.
Right.
That's a threat.
Yeah.
So quite frequently, you see a combination of bribes and threats used in everybody's day-to-day life. I don't do that with people. You know that I don't do that with you at home. And I don't do that with people in my day-to-day interactions with people. I don't have a motivation of manipulating people. Mm-hmm. I have a motivation of just saying the truth and being myself while I'm there present in that particular situation. They're my only motivations. And as a result of that, people often around me are confronted because I'm often not what they want me to be. I'm not what they like, oftentimes, and I'm not responding to their desire for a bribe. So many times people want to be bribed. You know, they want to have the interaction of, don't you say any truth to me and I'll promise not to say any truth to you. They want that interaction because they're so afraid of the truth themselves. Mm-hmm. So I don't engage in those kind of behaviours at all. What I like to do with people is I like to be open and frank and truthful about my own feelings, and open and frank and truthful about what I'm feeling from the other person. And if what I'm feeling from the other person is what I believe to be unloving or violent in its nature, then I don't want to spend any time with them. If what I'm feeling from the other person is enjoyable and pleasant to be with, and by the way, a person can tell me the truth about myself because I'm perfectly able to receive it, as everybody who's close to me knows. If they can tell me something about myself, I'm perfectly okay with that. I often find that people are not perfectly okay with even telling me that.
Mm.
So we have a lot of emotional investments, I feel, as a society, in not sharing the truth with each other. And we have a lot of emotional investments in maintaining specific emotional status quo. In other words, many people have an emotional investment of don't make me cry. In other words, don't discuss anything with me that is relating to my past that will cause a tear to come up in my eye, because then I might get overwhelmed with an emotion that I'll have to experience and I don't want to experience. You know, a lot of people don't make me feel ashamed. For many people, just saying the truth about their life makes them feel ashamed because they did shameful things during their life. Mm-hmm. And so they feel ashamed when you start speaking of the truth about their life. I don't believe that is shaming them. I believe that is being truthful. If you had an emotion of judgment about what they'd done, now that's shaming them.
Hmm.
Yeah, so my feelings are speaking the truth is important to every single person in my life. And if the person wants the truth, then I'll enjoy their company a lot. If they don't want the truth, then they'll obviously get angry with me or resistive in some way, and I won't want their company very much.
Hmm. You were mentioning about manipulative, the accusation, I suppose, is often made that you're manipulative.
Mm-hmm.
And
I don't feel it's often made, by the way.
No.
I don't. In the course of an entire year, I might hear the accusation once or twice.
Yeah, let's say it's consistently made by the media.
Right. It's consistently made by the media and a few of attacking individuals who just don't like me.
Who are not the majority of people we know at all.
No.
Yeah. But I just found it interesting that you're talking about this idea of manipulating people through bribery and threats. And that's actually, from what you're saying, that's true manipulation. Why do you think it is that people find you stating the truth to be manipulative?
Well, I feel, again, a lot of times it relates to their childhoods. And many times the only time a child heard the truth was when the parent was trying to manipulate them to do something. So I find that very unfortunate, that the underlying motivation of many parents to tell the truth is only to manipulate the child into taking some course of action. Now, of course, if a person's grown up with that, they'll automatically assume that anybody who's telling them the truth is wanting to manipulate them in some way. And I find that very unfortunate. But that is a statement more about their own parents than it is about myself. So when a person accuses me of manipulating them just when I speak the truth, my instant knowing is that they have had a very manipulative childhood where their parents have attempted to manipulate them using the truth.
Yeah, I suppose what I'm asking is, if you're stating the truth, it's not manipulative.
No.
I see that. Why is it when the parents are stating the truth, it's a manipulation? What else is going on?
Well, manipulation depends upon the intent of the person. So if the intent of the individual is to create a different behaviour because of a statement of truth, then that is manipulation. Mm-hmm. I don't have an intent to change a person's behaviour or manipulate their behaviour with myself. I just have an intent to live in harmony with truth. So it depends very much upon the intent of the individual. If my intent of telling you the truth was to manipulate you by making you feel guilty, then of course I would be manipulating. But I don't tell people the truth in order to make them feel guilty. I tell the truth in order for a person to face up to the truth and help them. And I help them emotionally through the process as well. So as you know, I've told you the truth many times, and I've always stood there and helped you through the process of dealing with that truth as well. I didn't tell you that truth in order to make you feel worse about yourself. I've just said, no, darling, this is the truth. This is what you did.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to see what you've done before you can change. And this is the same intent that I have with everyone. Many times parents don't have that intent. Their intent is to modify the behaviour of the child. And many people who tell the truth in the world today have the intent of modifying the behaviour of the person. I don't agree with that intent. I don't have that intent. I'm hoping that a person will modify their own behaviour by hearing the truth, but only through that mechanism, not because I'm trying to force them into shame or guilt.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, if they feel shame or guilt, I try to assist them through those emotions, as you know, in order to help alleviate their shame and guilt so that they can just focus on the truth of what happened.
Sure.
Mm.
Thank you. Have you ever told people they'll go to hell if they don't follow what you teach?
Like the Bible does. And I don't even know if the Bible really does, to be frank. I feel that there's many statements in the Bible which would indicate that's not true anyway. But yeah, most religions, and particularly Christian religions, do basically say that if you don't do what the Bible says, then you'll go to hell and that you'll be there forever. You'll be in eternal torment in a location that you are in which you are in extreme pain. I do not agree with that at all. I don't feel that anybody will go to hell for any action. I believe oftentimes we are already in hell because of the actions we have taken. And when I say that, what I mean is the way God has constructed her universe is that whenever I take an action that's out of harmony with love and truth, my soul already degrades in its condition and I already experience a hell of a sort. And it begins oftentimes with a sore conscience, but for those who don't have a sore conscience, it often happens that many external events occur showing them that the choices that they were making at that particular time are resulting in their own pain and suffering. Mm-hmm. So I feel that the majority of people are already experiencing a hell of a sort in the sense that they are experiencing the hell of their own unloving choices and the choices of others' unloving behaviour forced upon them in their current life. I don't think you need to threaten anybody with that. I feel you need to alleviate people. Sorry, I just need to have a cough. I feel you need to alleviate people from the burden of that kind of thinking. The way you do that is by demonstrating to them that any behaviour they engage that is out of harmony with love and truth will result in breaking one of God's laws, which automatically has, let's call it a penalty. I would prefer to call it an operation. It's a bit like the operation of gravity. If you break the law of gravity, you can't really break it, like in the sense of break the law itself. You can only attempt to not be governed by the law. So if I'm standing on a very tall building, 20 stories high, and I attempt to not be governed by the law of gravity, I might step off the edge of it. And the law is going to have its operation. Whether I agree with its operation or not is really immaterial. The law has its operation. All of God's laws are like that. And God has laws that govern the soul, that morality, ethics, and a lot of other things that people are not aware of. And if I help people become aware of these particular laws that God has, then they'll be able to choose whether they still want to attempt to break or attempt to not be governed by that law or not. Now, my suggestion is that any attempt to not be governed by one of God's laws is an exercise in futility that will always result in pain and suffering. So I believe pain and suffering is the direct result of our personal attempts or the attempts of our environment to not be governed by God's laws that God has already set up. If I can help a person understand those laws, then I can help a person choose to be governed by the laws, and that will result in more happiness. But I cannot force that upon them. That has to be a personal choice that they make. You think about it, you can't force a person to take a certain action except by being with them 24 hours by 7 days a week for their entire life. And I certainly do not want to do that. I want to live my own life. I don't want to spend all of my life trying to govern billions of people's lives by being with them 24 by 7 and telling them off every time they choose to do something personally against God's laws and rewarding them every time they choose to do something in harmony with God's laws. Such a proposition is ludicrous. And I would never consider doing it, and nor would any sane person, I believe. So my suggestion is that people need to understand that whenever there is pain and suffering in their lives, it is the direct result of a lack of harmony with God's laws, and therefore something that they can personally choose to change. Okay. I don't know if I answered the question, did I?
The question was if you've told people they're going to go to hell if they don't follow what you teach. And
the brief answer to that, of course, is no. But many people do finish up going to hell, as the statement says, but as a direct result of the choices they've already made, mm-hmm. not of something they will make in the future necessarily. Obviously, if they continue to make negative choices in the future, then they will go to places in the spirit world that reflect their condition. But one thing I must say in this question too, though, is that hell is not a place that you can't get out of. Hell is a place, many people on earth are in hell in a certain period of their life, in the sense they have all tormented emotions over a certain period of their life. And then as they progress and work their way through that emotionally, they get out of that state. It's exactly the same after a person passes into the spirit world. They might be tormented initially by certain things that they've done in their life and they'll feel like they're in hell. But after a while, they can get out of that state and be in more heavenly, shall we call them, places, more beautiful places where they're not in torment.
Great. Have you ever promised people would be successful in their business or personal life if they follow what you teach?
Well, it's an interesting question because in a way, if a person does follow the principles of divine love and divine truth in their personal life, now all of God's laws are working in harmony with their choices. Now, naturally, that's going to result in a pretty positive life, a very happy, fulfilling, beautiful life. The problem, though, is that we live in a world that is very much against doing things in harmony with love, truth, and humility. And there are many spirits that surround us on a day-to-day basis that also live out of harmony with love, truth, and humility. As a result, those particular people will oppose what we do. So we can't guarantee while a person is on earth, while the earth conditions are as they currently are, that they will automatically result in more happiness and more joy and more fulfillment in their life if they follow the principles of divine truth. Because when they follow the principles of divine truth, there are other things in the world as it currently stands that oppose those principles. Mm-hmm. They oppose the principles of free will, for example. They oppose the principles of love. They oppose the principles of honesty. They oppose the principle, lots of different principles that we're teaching. Now, because of that, you basically on earth have this sort of separation, if you like, that occurs where those people who are practicing principles of love, truth, and humility feel and can often be attacked by the people who do not want to practice the principles of love, truth, and humility. I put to everyone, though, that if the people saying that they are practicing the principles of love, truth, and humility attack others, then they are not practicing the principles of love, truth, and humility. But if a person is practicing the principles of love, truth, and humility that we teach, then they could have a positive life, but that is now dependent upon how the people who are out of harmony with those principles wish to act towards them. So we cannot promise that a person is going to have a much more happier, fulfilled life because there is the potential of attack coming from another group of people when they follow the principles of love, truth, and humility.
So what is to be gained if people follow the teachings?
Well, immense things. Firstly, you learn the truth of the universe from God. You learn that you come to have a purely loving relationship with God. You receive divine love. As you receive divine love, your soul is open to absorbing the truths of the universe. So you begin absorbing all of the truths of the universe. You have no fear. You get to a point in the future where there is no fear at all within you. So you no longer live by any fear at all. You become at one with God through this process. So now everything you choose to do is completely in harmony with love and truth. So there are just immense benefits from following the principles of love and truth. However, while you live in the world as it is currently, there is the potential still of you being attacked because of the choices that other people make. Now, obviously, the more people who make a choice for love and truth, the less people there will be who wish to attack, and there will also be less people who respond to fear of attack. And as a result of that, the world can also change and eventually become a loving place too. So there are immense personal benefits. There is immense universal benefits in terms of the rest of your existence, infinite benefits for your life. But there is also the benefits of living how you live your life now and the potential benefit of the whole world changing as a result of your choices.
Hmm. Thank you. Do you have a slick well-rehearsed public relations front.
Well, you've been with me now for, what, 5 years, haven't you, darling? As you know, I'm pretty much identical in public as I am in private, right? So I wouldn't call that a slick public relations front. If I've got a slick front, then it's always there all the time. I think, though, and this is one of the reasons, too, why we don't edit videos and we don't, you know, we just put things on as they are, because we feel quite strongly that things should be presented exactly in the manner in which they occurred. We don't feel that truth is served by modification or prettying up something. It is how it is. What happened, happened. Warts and all, it happened. And we feel, even with ourselves, warts and all, we're happy to present ourselves truthfully to everyone. Everyone in that process will see how we change as we grow in love and as we grow in humility and truth. Everyone will see how we change. When we change, they'll be able to say, that's what he was like then and that's what he's like now, but that's very different. And that's what she was like then and that's what she's like now and that's very different. And they'll be able to make comparisons. And then they'll be able to see that what we're teaching actually works. Mm-hmm. If a person continuously makes a sort of like slick front, then you're getting a heavily modified version of what the person actually is. Now, that's not good for the person, because the person is, if they're really going to become in harmony with the principles of what we teach, they need to come face to face in, like I so often say in my presentations, like a mirror. It's like a mirror put in front of me that I can look at and go, come face to face with myself. And I need to come face to face with myself. So anytime if I desired to modify something, I'm not willing to come face to face with something in myself. So for example, if we did a video and then we found, oh, we didn't like that bit and we didn't like this bit and we didn't like that bit, they're all just things that we don't want to come face to face with ourselves about. It's far better to come face to face with ourselves about all things if we truly want to grow, particularly if we want to grow towards God. Because God sees ourselves as we truly are. He sees us clearly. We need to see ourselves clearly if we're ever going to become at one with God. So I don't believe in a slick public relations front. I believe in everything being just as it is, warts and all. That's my way of dealing with all issues.
Right.
Okay. Maybe I can point out too there, that sometimes with Lena and Igor, with editing the videos even, we've had these kind of things. They say, oh, should we take that out? I go, no, leave that in. That's fine. You know, like we can correct that later or whatever, if it's an error, rather than have it all nice and slick and polished, you know, because slick polish doesn't allow the character to show through. It also doesn't allow the audience to determine progress over a period of time. All it does is it's just a way of maintaining a facade. And I've done many talks about facade, maintaining facade. I've had a talk about the three selves, the facade self. We've had a talk about the facade self and what it, you know, what it is and what it prevents us from doing. So, you know, for us to then maintain a facade on any level would be completely hypocritical and out of harmony with our own teachings.
Do you edit any of the presentations you place on YouTube?
No, we don't edit the presentations we place on YouTube. We might trim off a bit of superfluous comments at the front of the presentation and at the end of the presentation where, you know, I'm talking about mundane things relating to the audience that's particularly there and not to a worldwide audience. But the actual presentation itself is unedited all the way through. When I say unedited, the guys who are doing the video obviously need to shoot to turn one video, turn everything into one video from two cameras or even three cameras. So that requires a process of switching. But we don't actually edit what happened. We don't cut bits out that we don't like what happened, where we don't like what happened, or cut bits out where we said the wrong thing, or cut bits out. That all stays in. And the beauty of it staying in is that it lets everybody see exactly what happened on the day. Now, if we need to correct something, then we'll come back later and we'll correct it by saying some more things. And I feel that is the way God also wishes us to be. God, anything that's happened in the past has happened. That's reality. We can't rewrite history. All we can do is correct it. If it was in error, we can correct it, but we can't rewrite it. So my feelings are, I want an accurate record of history, and if I need to correct it because I've learnt something new, or I've become more developed in love, or I've learnt a new truth, then I will correct it. When I know that truth, or when I've become more developed in love and to know that truth, I will correct it then, but not before then. Until that time, it will remain indelibly etched as it is, and it will always remain as a record. The beauty of that is that you have an accurate record of history. Unfortunately, with the way mankind creates history on the earth, it's very interesting because most of the time, history is not even written accurately. It is written by the people who want to give a certain slant to the history. And then later on, it's written even more, and some things are completely written out of history, in fact, and new generations of people don't even know that they even occurred. In the spirit world, it's very different because every record of history is a complete and accurate record of history. And often there is books with a comparison in the spirit world where they have a list of the thing that people on earth said happened and then what actually happened next to it. And it's a very interesting contrast. On earth, everyone wants to maintain a facade, wants to usually present themselves to be better than they actually are, wants to present the actual event to be better than it was. And as a result of that, there's a heavy desire to edit. I don't have those desires. I want things to be exactly as they are. And if I need to correct something in the future, something that I've done wrong in the past, then I'll correct it. Aside from that, no, I'm not going to correct it until I recognise that it's actually wrong.
Okay. Is everyone who comes to your seminars unhappy?
Well, it depends. It seems to depend on what seminar. I would say the majority of people who come to the seminars are searching for truth. Many of them are already quite happy and quite open-minded. That's why they're willing to come along to one of the seminars. But there are times when I say things in a seminar that causes them to feel about an emotional thing that happened in their childhood or something that happened in their life. And as a result, they'll have a cry. So they'll, in that moment, be unhappy. I feel this whole concept of happiness and unhappiness is very flawed as well on the planet, in the sense that we almost expect all of us to be happy all the time. And then when we're not happy all the time, we think something's wrong. But the reality is many of us have had very harsh childhoods, harsh lives. And particularly if we've lived in the third world or, you know, in some countries that don't have the same level of resources that we have in the Western world. And we've had very difficult lives, and we've got a lot to cry about, actually. We've got a lot to release that we have been sad about. And we've never had the opportunity to emotionally process it. So I believe a lot of people actually are very unhappy. In fact, I feel the majority of the world is very unhappy and afraid. And they're even afraid of their unhappiness. If we release this unhappiness and this fear, then we have the potential to have a very happy world and very happy individual lives. But we're not going to be able to do it by making out that nothing bad happened, by making out that the past didn't happen. We're going to have to do it by facing up to our past, both as humanity but also as individuals, and coming to terms with our past. When we do that, then we have the potential of being happy after we've experienced some unhappiness. I feel that when people come to the seminars, they're often like any normal person. They are a person who's trying to be happy, but often quite unhappy inside of themselves. They're a person who believes they are loving, when quite often they're quite unloving. And they're people who often think they know the truth, and then after a short discussion realise that maybe they don't know very much of the truth. And I feel the majority of the world's population would fall into those categories. I believe we don't have anything to fear from that. We only can learn from that.
Is everyone who comes to your seminars happy?
please refer to the discussion about everyone being unhappy.
Well, maybe we don't need to record an answer, if
and,
like.
Well, I think this could be included in that answer.
Yeah.
Together, I think, it could be included. Sure. Because the reality is that we all have the potential for extreme happiness. We also have the potential for extreme unhappiness. It all depends on how we choose to live our lives. If we choose to live our lives completely in harmony with love and truth and humility and receive divine love, then there is a high likelihood of living in extreme happiness in our life. If we choose to live our lives out of harmony with God's laws, out of harmony with love, not wanting to know the truth, denying the truth most of our life, not taking personal responsibility for our life, then we are choosing to live with a lot of pain and suffering. And so, you know, that is unfortunately the state of humanity. We are making these choices, and unfortunately, the majority of us finish up making choices based upon addiction, fear, and other emotions. And as a result of that, they're not choices based around love and truth, so it can only result in pain and suffering. And I feel even pain and suffering itself, while in itself it hurts. It also is a way for us to pause and go, oh, wow, I'm in a lot of pain and suffering. Mm-hmm. There must be something wrong mm-hmm. with my life. So it actually causes us to get to a state of humility at some point. So I feel that happiness, extreme happiness, is definitely possible. I also feel that extreme unhappiness is definitely possible. And it all depends on our choice, what we choose to do, the choices we make personally as to what will be the result. Now, obviously, many people who come along to my seminars are the same range of people as you would find in any normal day-to-day activity. As a result of that, there are some that are happy, there are some that are unhappy, and there's a wide range in between.
So you're actually saying that the people who attend the seminars represent a cross-section of society at the moment?
Yes, I feel they represent a cross-section of society, with one possible exception, and that is that they are open to a guy called Jesus saying some truths to them, which general society at this point in time is not open to receiving. Mm. So aside from that, they basically are very, very similar to any other person you would meet in society. They all come out of general society. They all come out of different experiences. There's a wide range of backgrounds. There's a wide range of socioeconomic backgrounds. There's a wide range of cultural backgrounds in every person that we meet that are attracted to divine truth. The only difference between the majority coming at this point and the average person is they are not afraid to come along to a person who says he's Jesus telling them something at a seminar. That's the main difference. And in fact, probably the only difference. Hmm. Many of them also have a desire for truth, and they're willing to try some things out that are sort of left of centre or right of centre, something that's not normal, what they feel is not normal. Although when they come and receive the divine truth from a seminar, they realise that I'm a very normal person speaking about very normal things in a very clear manner, and that is what often finishes up attracting people to have a longer term study of the divine truth.
Do you promise happiness for those who follow what you teach?
If a person sincerely follows exactly what I teach, they will become extremely happy. Definitely. That is definitely the case. It depends upon them following. There's the great big if. Many people who come to my seminars believe they are following what I'm teaching, when they are not. They believe they know what I'm talking about when I know they do not know. And this is the problem with terminology that we use. You know, on earth you have to have terminology to express things. You express things in a language. The problem with the expression of things in a language is that people think they assume, or they assume they know what you're talking about when they might not know the feeling involved of what you're talking about. It's very, very hard to discuss things with people who believe they know what you're talking about when they don't really know. And the only way they're really going to know is if they learn to practice the three primary principles of love, truth and humility, but particularly humility. And that is the biggest problem that I see in terms of people that come to the seminars. The majority of them are nowhere near humility when it comes to an assessment of the truth of their own lives. And as a result of that, they're not yet feeling what they actually feel. And so they think they know what I'm talking about when they're not yet experiencing it. Once they experience it, then they will know. And what I find for most people is that they realize that after a while. You know, you've said to me 3 years, you know, I think just recently you said, 3 years ago you told me that and I thought I understood and now I get what that means, you know. And many people have said that to me over the time, over my life, over the 2,000 years of my life, where they thought they knew what I was saying. And then when they went through a personal emotional experience, they realized that the experience was what I was saying. And I was trying to describe an experience to them that they themselves didn't really understand at the time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you encourage or teach people to leave their families?
Well, the only time I would encourage a person to leave their family was if the family was acting in a violent or unloving manner towards the person. And I would define an unloving manner as I've defined it in the talk that I gave about the gift of free will. And the way I've defined that is any action or words or expressions or manipulation that results in the family attempting to manipulate the free will of the individual. So the only time I would encourage a person to leave their family, and when I say encourage, it's probably not the right word, I would state to them that they would need to love themselves and leave their family. I wouldn't encourage them to. I wouldn't try to give them a carrot to dangle in front of them to show them a reason to. All I would just say to them is, look, if your family is treating you badly, if they're attacking you, deriding you, being condescending to you, belittling you, and also becoming violent with you in their words or their actions, then that's the time to leave somebody. And if that's your family, then leave them. Or if that's your partner, then leave them. If that's work, then leave it. If that's a business, then leave that. If that's, you know, anything in society that does that is out of harmony with love. So leave it. Other than that, stay with the situation and work your way through what issues there are. I feel a lot of people run away from situations with family, friends, you know, work colleagues, you know, businesses and all those other things in life. They run away from them because they don't want to face something in their own selves emotionally that it brings up within them. And they then use the excuse that they're being attacked or whatever, when sometimes the people that are saying the truth to them are not attacking them, they're just saying the truth to them. Mm-hmm. So I would take care if a person was considering leaving family, friends, relationships, businesses, whatever, workplace environments, whatever, you would have to be very honest with yourself that you're not just resistive to hearing the truth or whether you are actually having the feeling of attack coming from you where the other person is getting angry, condescending, belittling of you. That's a different thing altogether. A person can tell you the truth without being condescending, without being belittling, without attacking, without, you know, yelling at you and verbally abusing you or punching you or doing worse violent things towards you. They can easily tell you the truth without all of those things. If they're saying to you that they're telling you the truth while they're doing all of those things, then that's the time to leave the situation because it's not loving to yourself.
Do you encourage or teach people to come and live with you?
Aside from you, no.
I wouldn't even say you encouraged me, you just invited me.
I invited you, yeah. As you and I both feel, we love our privacy. We get, obviously because we share a lot with people, we do get very little private time. And so we treasure our private time. And as a result of that, we love our privacy. We definitely would never want to live with somebody else. Aside from that other person being a child that we had. My feelings about living with other people is that oftentimes you've got to deal with their emotional projections and their unloving behaviour and so forth. But not only that, even if they were perfectly loving, I would still love to spend private time with you and experience my life with you. And so I don't like to spend a lot of time with everybody all the time. I love sharing divine truth with people. I love it particularly when people want to hear it. And if people don't want to hear it, then I don't. But aside from that, I love to spend time alone with yourself or alone with myself, with God, either of those two things. We have never encouraged anybody to come and live with us. We have sometimes suggested to people when they've asked that they can live with us for a short period of time for a reason. But my personal feeling is that most people need to take, or all people need to take, personal responsibility for their living arrangements, which includes personal responsibility for their home, for their kitchen, for their welfare, for their life, for their food, for their clothes, for their shelter, and all of those other aspects of life. If sometimes we have visitors come to stay with us, but oftentimes it's a very short period of time that we like to have visitors. I don't think we've had many visitors in the last 3 or 4 years that haven't been here any longer than 1 week or less. Mm-hmm. And we prefer it that way because we love to have our personal time together. And we definitely would not ever have a compound where lots and lots of people live together. We would feel that to be a very strange living arrangement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Do you encourage or teach people to come and live near you because it's safe?
I have never encouraged people to come and live with me for any reason, safety or not.
Near you, this question.
Or near me, yeah, for any reason. Mm-hmm. Any person who's come to live near me, most of them have never discussed with me their desire to do so. They've often made the choice without any discussion with us. And I think with yourself, you would have preferred that they hadn't have, in many cases, come to live near us.
Oh, that's not...
Not always the case, but...
No, and that's not anything personal about those people. No. I just had some fears about us not having our private space together.
Exactly. Yeah. So, you know, the reality is we've never encouraged people to come and live near us for any reason, and particularly not for the reason of trying to maintain safety. We've taught people over and over again that safety is not about location. Safety is about what's going on inside of yourself and what you attract. You will attract very unsafe events if you have high levels of fear inside of you, whether you think you're safe or not. And we've told this to people over and over again. And many people have come to live near us, I understand, because they wanted to share more with divine truth. I don't see how that's the case either, because oftentimes we're not here. And the only real way of sharing divine truth with us on more occasions is to be present with more of our seminars, no matter where we are. And that would probably mean travelling around in a similar way that we have been travelling around, which I suppose would then make somebody a groupie. And again, we don't really encourage that either. We encourage people to feel about their own desires and passions in their life, and then to follow those desires and passions with passion. And we feel that that will take them to many different places around the world like it's taken us, and it will take them into many different experiences which will be very enjoyable for them.
So from what you're saying, you don't feel that people need to live near us in order to experience more divine truth even?
No, not at all. In fact, what we often find is the people that live near us get more attack from spirits, because there are many spirits around us at times opposing divine truth. And often when people come to live near us, they feel more feelings of attack from spirits when they come to live near us. And that's often the case with seminars too. People have often commented when they come to a seminar that sometimes they feel attacked at the seminar by spirits. And that's because there are a lot of spirits wanting divine truth to not succeed on the planet. And as a result, they'll do anything to try to impede the success of divine truth on the planet. So, yeah, my feelings are, come and live near us if you want to, but make sure it's because it's a personal passion that you're fulfilling of doing something enjoyable in your own life that you wanted to do before you met us. Mm-hmm. Or after you've heard divine truth, if you find that you want to share in the delivery of divine truth to the world, yes, well, we'd be happy to have as many people as could help us in that process. And mm-hmm. We find that there's some who are very sincere in helping us with that process, and we love engaging those kind of people. But obviously we're going to want the sincerity. If if we're going to engage that process. Quite often people want things from us when they come to live near us. And to be honest, you're not going to get anything from us if you come to live near us any more than you'd get anything from us if you lived apart from us.
Do you say, or have you ever said, that there is a doomsday or Armageddon?
No, there is no such thing as Armageddon or a doomsday. I believe quite, and I've been quite open about this, that I believe quite strongly that there is no such thing as an Armageddon, as the Bible states. The Bible states there is an Armageddon. I do not agree. There's no such thing as a doomsday, which is taught in many religions and also taught in a lot of New Age concepts. I don't agree with such teachings at all. I believe that there will be, that there are the potential, there is the potential of future events that will probably be called cataclysmic on the planet, just like there has been in the past events that have been cataclysmic on the planet. However, I don't see any big impact upon these events, because any person who passes into the spirit world, they have a continual existence. And so I don't see there needing to be any threat of such events. We need to understand that we have a continuous life and therefore need to have nothing to fear aside from the choices we make. That's the only thing we've got to fear, really. And even then, I wouldn't say to fear. We just need to learn from the choices that caused us pain and suffering. I feel the biggest doomsday there is the day you choose to stay in pain and suffering. And many people are choosing to do that mm-hmm. every day, mm-hmm. choosing to stay in pain and suffering, choosing to not release emotions that cause them to remain in pain and suffering. And I feel that that's a personal doomsday for each person, really. It's sad when I see people doing that, because we have such potential to change and grow. And our potential to change and grow is infinite as human souls. And this is something that we teach all the time. So when people choose to remain in pain and suffering, I feel that's a personal doom for them. But it's not a doomsday. And I feel people also refer to a judgment day. And I believe that judgment day is every moment. Every moment you're faced with choices and decisions. Some of those choices and decisions you make are out of harmony with love. And because they're out of harmony with love, you will have the consequence that is painful as a result.
But are you saying that God is judging us?
No, God's laws are in operation. Remember, I've stated in many discussions about God's laws, and I suggest to people to look at the presentations about God's laws, because God's laws are always in operation. It's like the law of gravity. It's always in operation. We have the choice to ignore it to our detriment. It's the same with all of God's moral laws. It's the same with all of God's spiritual laws. And it's the same with all of God's laws about love that operate upon the soul. We have the choice to our detriment to ignore the law if we so desire, but it will be to our detriment. It will be to our own pain and suffering. So whenever I'm in pain and suffering, I need to look at the choices that I've made and reappraise the choices that I've made. Once I become at one with God, even if other people attack me, I still won't feel pain and suffering. In the first century, after I became at one with God, I didn't feel pain and suffering. Before then, I did. And before I was 30 years of age, I had quite a lot of pain and suffering in my life in the first century, most of which was the result of other people. After I became at one with God, even when other people treated me badly, I no longer experienced pain and suffering. So I believe when you feel pain and suffering, you have a great opportunity to be self-reflective and to change. And that is the primary way in which we experience either a lack of doom or doom in our lives. I do feel, though, that physical events on the planet are still a potential of occurring, even though 2012 has passed. And I don't believe that God times anything. You know, there's no date in God's eternal existence. There's no special date, special time. There are just experiences that occur as a result of choices that we make. And I do believe still that on this planet, mankind is still making many fear-based choices. As a result of that, a lot of violence is being perpetrated on the planet, but also not only violence towards humanity, but violence towards the Earth itself. And as a result, the Earth normally goes into corrective stances. And so there is still the potential of these events occurring in the future and in the near future, I believe. But that doesn't mean that it's a doomsday or an Armageddon.
Mm. My next question is, do you threaten people with a doomsday or an Armageddon? And perhaps we could extend that to this idea, do you threaten people with these cataclysmic or potentially cataclysmic events that you were talking about?
No, excuse me, I just need to have a cough. No, the only times I've discussed in the past things with people about so-called earth change events and so forth is when they have asked me the question. When a person asks me a question, whether I'm right or wrong, I will give the answer of what I feel at that time. Mm-hmm. And that's what I do. And as I grow and change, my answers sometimes will change. Obviously, there are some things that I'm remembering and there are other things that I'm learning. And obviously, with the things that I'm learning, my responses will definitely change. With the things I'm remembering, it's highly unlikely my responses will change because I've already gone through those processes emotionally. I've already come to recognise the truth about those particular things. So after 2,000 years of life, I have a memory of certain things and it's a wide variety of things. And those particular things, I don't think I will change in the future very much. There are certain things that I don't have no knowledge of. And one of those is the future. I don't know what choices people are going to make in the future. I don't know what effects those choices will have on the earth or their own lives. I'm not omniscient as God is. I don't have the ability to calculate all the potential occurrences or choices that a person may make and work out what the conclusion will probably be. All I have the ability to do is the same as everyone else, and that is to see the potentials of what we can potentially do in the future. And I feel the potential for the future is fantastic on the earth and in the spirit world. The potential on earth is that we can, you know, within 100 years, we could have an earth that is completely free of violence, completely free of war, completely free of weapons, completely free of everything. That's our potential. If everyone used their intelligence, that would definitely be the outcome. And we also have the potential to have a completely opposite thing occur, where, you know, where it was like in the 60s and 50s, where there was the potential of nuclear holocaust. We have that potential. Mm-hmm. And in the spirit world, it's a bit different. We don't have the potential of a nuclear holocaust, but we do have the potential of staying in the so-called hells, the places where it's dark and dingy and unhappy, for much of our life, if we choose to remain as we currently are. If we choose to change, we've got the potential of actually having everyone in those locations leave those locations. We've got the potential of not having any dimensions below the sixth dimension of the spirit world have any people in them because everyone's in a state of happiness. Mm-hmm. We have that potential. These are all the potentials, you know. The reality is every single moment of our lives, we are making choices. As soon as we make a choice, we're choosing a different life. We're choosing a different potential. That now becomes our reality. So we all have this ability to change our reality, to change what we actually experience by making different choices. What I would like to see is people make different choices. And I feel there's no need to threaten people with a future, because God's laws automatically correct them. Pain and suffering is the automatic result of living out of harmony with God's laws. Mm-hmm. And if we know that, that's one of the truths that we're sharing with people, and if we know that, then we know we can make, pain and suffering is an indicator, I've made the wrong choice. Mm-hmm. So I'm experiencing pain and suffering, I've made the wrong choice, I need to make a change to my choices. Once I do that, and I understand that principle, then I have a lot of power over my own life. I've got the ability to have a beautiful life after that. That's our potential. Yeah. And I don't believe there's any need to threaten people with any other potential.
Yeah.
What there is a need to do is inspire people with that potential. I feel on this planet there is a definite lack of positive thinking, a definite lack of inspiration, because most people are so... what's the word I'm looking for? It's like disillusioned,
cynical
mm-hmm. with life. They don't believe in any positive outcome anymore, because their experience in their past has been there hasn't been one. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying, no, the experience of that past where there hasn't been a positive outcome is the result of your choices that are out of harmony with God's laws. That's the reason why your past has been like that. If you can offer people the potential of this inspirational potential that we can all grow, we can all become perfect, we can all become perfected in love and truth, we can all become at one with God if we so desire, but even if we don't desire that, we still have the potential to live completely happy lives. As long as we acknowledge all of God's other laws and live in harmony with them, we will be without pain and suffering. Mm. That's our potential. There is the potential of no sickness, no harm, no violence, you know, people living long, very, very long lives and potentially forever on earth if they wanted to, even if they didn't want God. There's this potential if they brought things into harmony with God's laws. But unfortunately, most people don't understand that. And so they keep choosing things that are out of harmony with God's laws. And as a result, they choose pain and suffering.
Mm. Mm. That's a good thought.
Mm.
Do you teach that people will be saved if they listen to you?
Let's define saved, shall we? There is this concept in Christianity that somehow my blood saves people, or my body saves people, or faith in me saves people. None of these things actually save anybody. What is going to save a person from pain and suffering, if we're looking at what is the term saving? What is going to save a person from pain and suffering is living in harmony with all of God's laws of love. Mm-hmm. That is going to save a person from pain and suffering. If I share what I know as God's laws of love and truth, then I potentially am saving people by sharing that truth, but only by sharing the truth. I could liken it to a person who is rowing in a boat and there's a person drowning in the water. You can throw them a life raft of some kind, mm-hmm.
a buoy.
You can throw them the life raft of some kind, and in a way, then you've saved them, right? You can pull them out of the water and then you've saved them. But that doesn't mean that you're better than them. It just means that you are in a position to give something that they needed in order to get out of their current condition. That's all. So I do believe that if a person listens to the divine truth, they have the ability to be saved from pain and suffering. They do. Of course, they're going to have to go through some pain and suffering, because there's pain and suffering often stored in them emotionally before they feel saved. But secondly, this option of this talk about being saved, I need to clarify more. And that is, I believe that we have the capacity of being turned into a new type of soul. I feel God made us one type of soul, which I would call the soul of the natural man, the natural woman, natural humankind. That soul has the capacity to grow without God to the point of happiness, to the point of living in the sixth dimension of the spirit world, if they've passed, or in living in perfect happiness and peace here on earth. Everyone could have different ideas and different concepts and everything, but live in complete peace with each other under that condition.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I believe. I don't call that being saved. I call that being happy. To me, being saved is becoming at one with God. Once you become at one with God, this infinite realm of possibility becomes possible. Everything that was before impossible is now possible. And this process of becoming at one with God is only available through God's process. It's not, no man, including myself, has designed the process. God designed it. And we have to either engage it or not engage it. That is our choice. It's like every one of the other of God's laws. You either engage it or you don't. That is your choice.
Mm-hmm.
The beauty of engaging this wonderful law, this law of divine love, is that it can transform your soul into a new creature, one that is not bound by the finite controls of the original soul, and also by the finite laws that original soul was constrained by. And that's what I'm teaching. I call that truly being saved, truly being saved is becoming born again into this loving arrangement with God where you are at one with God. And every new thing comes to you in that state. This is the state that we're trying to describe to people. So we have the capacity to be happy without having that state. But supreme or infinite happiness is not going to be possible without that state. And that's what I'd encourage people to do. So I do believe that if people listen to that, they will be saved.
Mm-hmm.
But not by anything that I have done for them, but rather by everything that God has done for them. God is the person who created these laws. God is the person who created or gave her own love. She is the person who heals us. I can't do that. So I can't heal another person. God's love heals the other person. The only way I can assist in the healing is by throwing the person the lifeboat,
mm-hmm.
by throwing the person the rope, if you like, that will pull them to that condition. And I can only do that because God threw me the rope in the first instance.
Do you control people by using their fears to control them?
Definitely not. I feel this is what the media and politicians frequently do. What they do is they find things that inside of people generally and that where people feel unsafe, and then they manipulate the safety. They either cause them to feel more fear and then choose a certain action, or they cause them to, they bribe them with feeling less fear, and so they choose a different type of action. And I believe this is a very, very common form of manipulation, because it's often the form of manipulation that most parents use with their own children in order to get the child to do a certain thing or not do a certain thing. So often a child was threatened with punishment if they did the wrong thing, or they were given a bribe, you know, a carrot on a stick, if you like, if they do the right thing. And this is all a part of manipulation through fear, through our fears. I don't do that. I just state very clearly to a person, you have this fear and you need to release it. You need to feel it to release it. You need to go through the feeling of it to release it, is what I say to them.
So in the situation you talked about with the parent earlier, you were saying a parent might threaten a child. Are you saying to invoke their fear? But that's different to what you're saying you do.
Yes, so they might threaten a child with some future punishment, right, to invoke a certain fear in a child, so the child goes ahead and does a certain thing that the parent wants them to do.
So that's, the child isn't feeling their fear in that situation?
Not at all. The child is experiencing the threat of a future fear. And because the child is afraid of the parent already, because usually the parent's already hit them, or already, the child has had demonstrated to it that the parent is capable of such behaviour. As a result of that, the child will not engage the action that it would like to engage.
Mm-hmm.
And parents frequently use this as a form of manipulation of the child's behaviour, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's not what I'm doing when I'm talking about fear with people. When I'm talking about fear with people, I'm trying to help people release their fear. I want them to not be governed by fear anymore, so they have a clear mind and are able to make decisions, wise decisions, that are not governed by some unhealed emotional trauma from their childhood.
Mm-hmm.
We often have huge unhealed emotional traumas from our childhood that cause us to fear things that we don't need to have any fear of. For example, how many people in Australia are afraid of snakes? Quite a lot, right? Because snakes in Australia are poisonous. How many people have actually died from a snake bite in Australia?
A far smaller percentage than those.
Well, I don't think there is even one a year. There's more people dying from shark attacks than there are from snake bites in Australia. But there's more people probably afraid of
snakes than sharks,
because there's probably less people that go into the water. But the reality is, snakes are just these tiny little creatures, really. How many of them are as big as a human? Right. Let's look at spiders. How many people are afraid of spiders? You know, there must be tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. Whenever a person comes to Australia, they're generally afraid of the spiders here, right? And yet the spiders are tiny little creatures. Like, it makes no logical sense to be afraid of one.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they're poisonous, it makes no logical sense to be afraid of one, because it's quite easy to you know, destroy it even.
Yeah.
It makes no logical sense to be afraid of one. But lots of us are afraid. Why are we afraid? Because events happened in our childhood that caused us to be afraid. And these events are still manipulating our lives. Mm-hmm. They're still controlling what we do. If a person releases these terrors and fears related to their childhood and how their parents viewed these kind of things, they will grow up without any fear. And as a result, they won't be afraid of snakes, spiders, or any other thing. They won't be afraid of death. They won't be afraid of, you know, lack. They won't be afraid of starving to death. They won't be afraid of any of these things, right? Because they will have released the emotions that cause those fears. That's what we need to do. Mm-hmm. If we live in those fears, we're going to be governed by them the rest of our existence. And that includes our existence in our spirit world. What we need to do is release the fears so we're no longer governed by them. Once we've released them, we now have the potential of embracing our real life without fear.
Hmm. What do you do to help people feel less afraid?
Well, there's nothing I can do to help a person feel less afraid except perhaps one thing, and that is to tell them the truth. The truth always overcomes fear. However, that is only going to happen if they're willing to release their fear by experiencing it. You cannot tell somebody the truth and they hold on to the experience of their own fear and expect them to have less fear. The reality is while they refuse to experience their fear will remain no matter how much truth you tell them. And this is what I find happening a lot in our seminars. I am trying to encourage people to experience their fear. That's the reason why I talk about it, because I want to help them experience their fear, because I know that when they fully experience their fear will be gone, and then they will be able to live a life completely in harmony with love and truth. But the majority of people hear those words and then they try to be less afraid without experiencing their fear, and that is impossible. So all I can do is share the truth with the person that they don't need to be so afraid of their fear. They need to experience their fear to release it. And they need to not be afraid of the experience of their fear, because it's just another emotion. If I can get across that particular truth and people start to relieve themselves of their fears by experiencing them, then they'll no longer get angry. They'll no longer have fear or rage govern their life, and their life will change substantially. That's what I'm trying to encourage people to do.
Do you have power over people?
Well, I believe that every single person on this planet has the potential of having power over another person. You know, you can just say something and it cause a change in another person's life. So, yes, you do have power over another person's life if they allow that thing to have power over them.
So then do you have power over them, or do they give you power over them?
Well, it depends. Sometimes it's worth giving somebody power to change a life, isn't it? Like I've read many, many books in my past, and also listened to many people in my past through my last 2,000 years that have changed my assessment of how things work and changed my experimentation, my desire to experiment with something different. And in a way, they've had a power over my life. Mm-hmm. I think that's wonderful, because mm-hmm. it's been a positive effect on my life. But I've chosen, through my free will choice, to take that action. It's different when you force something upon somebody. So what I'm suggesting is that when we choose to force something upon somebody, now we are way out of harmony with the use of our power. The reality is, each of us have a huge amount of personal power. Mm-hmm. All of us have the personal power to change the world we live in. All of us, right, have that personal amount of power. It's how we use our power that matters. Now, if we use our power to attack people, denigrate people, pull them down, destroy them, make them feel worse about themselves, make them feel guilty, to violently abuse them, then we are using our power in a very destructive manner to both them and ourselves. If we use our power to encourage, upbuild, strengthen, give purpose, help people be self-responsible, now we're using our power in a very positive direction to help people in that positive direction of changing themselves and the world around them. That's the way I use my power. That's the way I'd encourage everybody else to use their power. And unfortunately, most people on the planet use their power for a mixture of things, sometimes upbuilding and encouraging, sometimes destructive. And my suggestion is every time you use your power in a destructive manner, there will be pain and suffering for the person who you've used your power against and also for yourselves in the future. My suggestion is to not do that. I've learned enough about life to not do that myself.
Do others feel that you have power over them?
Sometimes I feel other people do believe I have power over them. I feel one reason why they believe that is because I know a lot of things about people because I can feel the truth of what their life has been. And often I feel what happens when I'm interacting with a person is I often feel a record of their life, right the way through their life, the choices they've made, but also what has been perpetrated against them as well. And so I often can feel those particular things from a person. Now, sometimes other people can feel that I can feel that, and then they become quite frightened. And the reason why they become frightened is because they worry about how I'm going to use that information. But I can't use that information in an unloving manner without breaking my own ethics and without breaking my own relationship with God. So my suggestion to people is they have no need to fear me at all, even if I know lots of things about them that nobody else knows. There's no need to fear me. There is also no need to fear me for any other reason. Like, all I want to do is share truth with the world. That's all I want to do. That's my primary motivation, as you know. And there's nothing to fear with that, except if you want to hold on to an error, then perhaps there is some things to fear. Many people, I feel there are many organisations and institutions and people on this planet who are afraid of the average person having more knowledge of truth. You know, there are many institutions and governments and people on the planet who, and religions on the planet, who do not want the members of their particular government, religion or institution knowing more about truth. This has always historically been the case. The Catholic Church during the Dark Ages refused to translate the Bible, for example, into different languages that the average person could read for this one reason, because they didn't want to find out, they didn't want the average person to find out what the Bible actually said about certain things. It's a way of controlling people. And my feelings are sharing the truth with people is a way of freeing people. Right? If you withhold the truth from people, then you're being controlling. So when you withhold the truth from your friend that her husband's cheating on her, you're controlling your friend's behavior. You're not giving her the choice to make it. You're not giving her the freedom to make a choice because she believes something completely different. When you control people's behavior like that, then you are certainly not in harmony with love or in harmony with truth. And there's always going to be negative future consequences. Sooner or later, the person's going to find out the truth. Sooner or later, they're going to realize that you didn't tell them the truth. Sooner or later, they're going to be hurt by that. The beauty of the truth is that people know straight away what they're getting, and they know straight away what's happening, no matter how bad it is. And this is something that is a loving thing to give to people.
Do you claim that the group of people who come to your seminars are better than others and will have a better life than others?
I feel actually that many people who come to my seminars are sometimes worse than others in the sense that they sometimes get a bit self-righteous and judgmental of others, and that automatically makes them worse than other people who are not judgmental or self-righteous. So, it depends a bit on the person's attitude. I feel that the people who come to my seminars are, as I have stated many times, the same as the average person on earth, with probably one or two exceptions. One exception is that they are willing to come to a seminar where a guy called Jesus is speaking, which indicates a certain degree of emotional openness and, and also an open mind, perhaps more open mind than the majority of people. Second thing that attracts most people to my seminars is a desire for truth, because that's all they get every time they come. They don't get somebody feeding them a heap of addictions. They don't get somebody making them feel better about themselves or making them feel worse about themselves. They just get somebody telling them the truth. And some of those people who come are very attracted to that. And I believe that's a beautiful trait, actually. That's something that I'm attracted to in people. And I believe that, you know, I can understand why that other people are attracted to those seminars for that reason. I do not believe that makes them better than others. In fact, in many cases, some of the people who come to the seminars have lived very bad lives in the sense of immoral and unethical lives. And they will have many things to work their way through if they want to have a relationship with God. In fact, many of them will have many more things to work their way through than the average person on the planet because of the way in which they've treated other people. But as was said about me in the first century, the sinners come to share with me. And why that was said was because I don't judge people for what they've done in the past. So many people feel attracted to that. I state truthfully what they've done without judging them.
Well, see, earlier you said that people are worse. I didn't expect you to say anyone is better or worse. So perhaps isn't that a judgment?
No, I mean, if I can clarify what I mean by worse, yeah. I mean that they have been more unloving in their past than the average person. Mm-hmm. So many of the people who come along to seminars have been more unloving in the past than the average person has been. And this is one reason why they come, because they're in so much pain and suffering that they want a relief for it and they want to find out how to get out of this pain and suffering. That's one of their motivations for coming. So this is why many so-called sinners were attracted to me in the first century, for the same reason. They had pain and suffering in their personal lives, which was an indication that their past, they had made choices that were worse, if you like, or more out of harmony with love than the average person's choices. But I don't judge that. All I do is help them change by giving them the truths that I've learnt myself.
And I suppose the question is driving at two important issues. Do you claim that the group of people who come to your seminars are better than others? So now that they've come, even if they've had a life that you might regard as sinful, would you call them better people than the average person now?
No, I feel the mark of whether somebody is becoming better in their life, and I think it's more of a personal comparison than a comparison with another person, is how more humble you're becoming about your life and how more truthful you're becoming about your life. I've seen many people come to my seminars for many years who are not an ounce more truthful or humble than when I first met them. And I feel that's quite sad, but it is a statement of truth. Mm-hmm. I also see some who have come to the seminars who have changed immensely since I've known them. They've become much more humble and much more truthful in their life. So I feel they've definitely changed for the better in their personal comparison with their self. I don't feel a feeling of judgment towards them. I just feel it's a shame that a person would come for 3 years and listen to 40 or 50 seminars and not change. That's an indication of quite a lot of resistance inside of them, and also quite a lot of addiction. I also find it immensely beautiful to watch a person change just by coming to one seminar. I think that's amazing. And, whenever a person does that, I think it's just wonderful, because their life changes before their eyes, you know, almost. It can change so rapidly. So I find either state, like, is an indication of some truth about the individual.
Yeah, and I suppose the question is asking, do you feel you're creating an elite group of people?
Definitely not. If a person followed my teachings, they would never believe themselves to be elite. they will always believe themselves to be a part of humanity and a brother and sister of any other person who's on the earth. They would also have more compassion for other people because they'd realise what they themselves have had to go through in order to become better people. Mm-hmm. So when you've had to personally go through traumatic, painful experiences in order to become a better person, you are usually much more humble about other people and the traumatic experiences they face in order to become a better person. You don't judge them. You judge them far less than you would have before then. So my suggestion is that if anybody who's coming to my teachings are judging other people, then they are definitely not in harmony with my teachings. They're definitely not in harmony with the reception of God's love. They're definitely never going to become at one with God in that state.
So are you saying that if they believe they are better than other people, who, whether they're coming to the seminars also or people in society, then they're in...
They are already more unloving than the average person.
Yes.
If they believe themselves to be better than the average person and to be more worthy than the average person, then they themselves are already in a worse condition of love than the average person. Mm-hmm. Their judgment is causing them to be in such a condition. Judgment is a huge problem in religion, in all sorts of ways of life, but particularly in religious practice on this planet. Because what happens for most people who learn a certain type of religious practice is they start judging all the other people who don't practice it. A person who truly practices the principles of divine truth that I've taught for 2,000 years will never fall into that trap. I've stated over and over, both in the first century and in this life, that anybody who judges another, and remember, judgment is an emotion projected towards the other person that they are less than or more unworthy than yourself. Anybody who has that particular emotion towards another person is already severely out of harmony with love. And as I said in the first century, it would be better if a noose was tied around their neck and they threw themselves into the sea than undertook such a decision to judge another person, because that's what's happening to their soul. Their soul is severely degrading in its condition as they judge. A person who's truly practicing the principles that I teach will not judge another. They will support others in their choices and decisions, but they will speak the truth. They will be loving under all circumstances. They will often remove themselves from people who are attacking them, and that is fine. That's not a judgment. That's just a feeling of love towards oneself. Mm-hmm. And a true person who is practicing these principles will not feel themselves to be better than any other person on this planet. I don't feel myself to be better than any other person on this planet. One of the main reasons why people get all shocked when they hear me say that I'm Jesus is because they believe I'm saying that I'm better than them. I am not saying that at all. I'm saying I am Jesus, but I am not better than you. That's what I'm saying.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, darling.